Hello and welcome to part 4 of the IADC's documentary, through which we continue to chart the construction of the Argyle International Airport, its progress, setbacks, and the determination of a government to fulfill a Vincentian dream. 2013 was described as a critical year for the Argyle International Airport project, with the projection being to complete all major construction work on the airport as airport officials look forward to a 2014 operation date. The main activities undertaken in 2012 were the excavation of soils and rocks in hilly areas, transportation of material excavated, and the creation of embankment in areas of the site that needed to be filled. In 2013, the main focus was to be the preparation of the runway for asphalt pavement and concrete pavement of the turning heads, apron areas and taxiways. All remaining earth and site works were to be completed by September 2013. The stone crusher that was commissioned in 2012 continued to produce stones, and the stockpiling continued in preparation for the laying of the base. It was expected that by the end of the first quarter of 2013, actual pavement works would begin. Work on the city fence, the control tower, and the aircraft rescue and firefighting station were also expected to commence by May 2013. During the construction of the Argyle International Airport, there were many bright spots. One of these was the revamping and relaunch of the IADC's website. The site was handed over to IADC on Thursday, February 14, 2013 by Mr. Andre Bailey, Director of Information Technology Services Division in the Telecommunications Department. The new website was considered a one-stop shop for SVG, doubling also as a marketing tool providing information for possible investors. Speaking at the handover, the Director of Information Technology Services Division, Andre Bailey, spoke to the fact that the website was built entirely in-house.
Proud to say that this resource was developed homegrown using open source technology. That means we didn't incur any cost in buying any applications to develop the site. This site was developed from in-house, and I'm proud to say this would be considered a very important national resource.
CEO of the IADC, Dr. Rudy Matthias, while thanking the telecoms division, congratulated the members of staff of the division who worked on the site. He noted that this is the type of collaborative effort that persons working on any national project should adopt.
My heart goes out every time I see the sort of collaboration that we have between IADC and the other organizations that are working on this airport project. In fact, this is the approach that we should take with any national project. When we came here, we never thought that IADC had the skills to do the project on its own. We have imported support from Cuba, from Venezuela, from Taiwan. There are Filipinos working here too. So that we have an international project. But even within St. Vincent, we have had significant support from many government agencies and civic organizations.
The bright spots surrounding the construction of the Argyle International Airport continued with local support for the project growing. This support was again brought to the fore with the staging on Sunday, May 19, 2013, of a cultural extravaganza which took place at the airport site. One of the first groups to show this type of community enthusiasm for the project was the Rose Hall Cultural and Development Organization, which staged a cultural display on Colonel Anderson's Hill in 2009 to rally support for the project and to raise funds as well. At that time, the money raised was just over $800. Being determined to contribute whatever they could to the end, the Rose Hall Cultural and Development Organization, with no money but lots of cultural capital at its disposal, came forward again on Sunday, May 19, 2013, to use their talents to rally support and raise funds for the Argyle Airport project. This was done through a cultural extravaganza, which took place in front of the offices of the IADC, and through which they managed to raise just under $3,000, which was donated to the airport fund. The following are some highlights from the cultural package.
Mm-hmm. say we're only dreaming.
In the meantime, other groups and organizations continue to lend their support to the project and made their contributions in one way or the other. It was the second time within the space of 6 months that the New York-based Friends of the Argyle International Airport was making a $10,000 donation towards the completion of the Argyle Airport project. The handing over of the check was witnessed by Governor General Sir Frederick Ballantyne, CEO of the IADC, Dr. Rudy Matthias, Treasurer of the Friends of the Argyle International Airport, Ms. Maureen King, Chair of the SVG Diaspora Committee, Maxwell Harewood, other members of the committee, and a wide cross-section of the media. In a brief address to the gathering, CEO of the IADC, Dr. Rudy Matthias, gave an update on the progress of the airport and what was expected in 2013. He also noted that the question on most people's minds at this time must be, can we complete the work by the end of 2013?
So let us reflect on where we came from when we started this international airport in 2005. Everyone here, I'm sure, has at least the memory of August 8, 2005, when the Honorable Prime Minister Ralph Gonsalves announced the airport project. And soon after that, there was so much discussion, and that is what it was meant to do anyhow, to generate discussion and debate in the country. And I don't want to sound negative because I don't have any negative bones in me at all, but I know there was a widely held view in St. Vincent that it was near impossible.
Treasurer of Friends of the Argyle International Airport, Maureen King, said her organization came about following a visit to the airport site by their president, Mr. Godfred Pitt. The organization promised to continue raising funds to assist with the completion of the airport. Following the presentation of the check, patron of the Argyle International Airport Contributory Fund, Sir Frederick Ballantyne, thanked the members of Friends of the Argyle International Airport for their continued support and urged others to do likewise and to do so quickly.
First, let me express my sincere thanks to the Friends of the Airport for this significant contribution. We all know how difficult things are in the world.
Meantime, a group of returning nationals calling themselves Returning Nationals SVG continued their own crusade to contribute to the construction of the Argyle International Airport until its completion. So by June 2013, they had organized a major fundraiser and plans were well advanced. At this time, the returnees had already contributed $75,000 to the AIA's contributory fund from their fundraising efforts, but that was not enough. They were determined to contribute more. Their latest effort was to raffle a Kia Sportage donated by the Mystique Airways and valued over $100,000. The winner of this Kia Sportage also received 1 year paid license and insurance. The effort was supported by Y de Lima, which donated a 4-burner oven stove as the second prize, and the third prize, a 3-night all-expense-paid stay at the beautiful Hotel Alexandrina. Ordinary Vincentians continue to take ownership of the Argyle International Airport through their continued contributions to the project. One of the many creative ways that persons sought to contribute came through the Drop a Dollar campaign initiated by Fitzhuggins with assistance from Projects Promotions. The campaign ended on Thursday, July 25th, after approximately 3 months, with a handing over ceremony on Friday, the 26th July 2013, at Government House. According to Huggins, the concept was to allow persons who did not want to go into the bank and stand on the line to deposit small sums of money to do so in a manner that was more convenient to them.
What we did is take the project to the streets, so to speak, and into the villages and towns, and allowed persons with as low as a dollar, and it proved to be as low as a few cents, really, to deposit whatever they could afford at a particular moment. So we had 12 bottles spread across the country where persons were able to deposit funds.
Although there were many bright spots, the construction of the Argyle International Airport was not without its setbacks, and in 2013 had its fair share of them. Even though the IADC had scheduled its work program to include the commencement of pavement at the end of the first quarter, it was still awaiting the arrival of the asphalt and concrete batching plants. The airfield lighting system had, however, begun arriving. Blasting activities at the site were also severely hampered, with the drill machines being out of commission since the latter part of 2012. Among the many setbacks for the AIA in 2013 was the death of the president of the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela, Hugo Chavez. Venezuela being one of the main contributors to the construction of the Argyle International Airport. Workers at the International Airport Development Company paid tribute to the late president Hugo Chavez during a memorial service on Friday, March 8th, held at the IADC. The service was attended by members of staff of the IADC, conducted by Monsignor George Badwell of the Catholic Church. During the memorial service, members of staff reflected on the many contributions made to the project by the late president. Even before the commencement of earthworks at the site of the Argyle International Airport, the contribution of the late Venezuelan President Hugo Chavez was evident. Let us look back at a bit of Chavez's contribution. Following Prime Minister Dr. Ralph Gonsalves' speech on August 8, 2005, where he announced plans to construct an international airport at Argyle, a team of Cuban and Venezuelan engineers and technicians began investigative work on the project. These works included complete topographic surveys of the area earmarked for the international airport, testing of the rocks and soils within the airport zone, and the commencement of wind studies to determine the best orientation of the main runway and the need, if any, for a shorter crosswind runway for smaller planes. Shortly after this, in the year 2006, three wind stations were delivered by Venezuela and were set up within the airport zone to collect wind data. Thereafter, a soil testing lab was set up at Argyle by Venezuela to ensure that only the best material was used on the runway and other parts of the project. In early 2007, the late President Chavez paid a visit to St Vincent and the Grenadines. He visited the office of the IADC accompanied by Prime Minister Dr. Ralph Gonsalves. On May 19, 2008, the first 13 pieces of heavy earth-moving equipment promised by the government of the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela arrived. These first pieces were followed by several other shipments, altogether numbering 37 pieces of heavy equipment and a variety of spares, costing US $10 million. The generosity of President Chavez did not stop there. St. Vincent and the Grenadines and the Argyle International Airport continued to benefit from the government of Venezuela by way of soft loans and Petrocaribe. Having understood the contribution made to the construction of the Argyle International Airport, it was easy to understand the personal loss felt by workers of the IADC when they heard of the death of President Hugo Chavez. It was this sense of loss which prompted the field workers who operated the heavy equipment sent to IADC by President Chavez to request a memorial service for the late president.
And they said, we have to do something. What can we do to celebrate his contribution and to honor him? So you could understand the pride that I felt when the field workers told me we need to have a service in honor of President Chavez. Some of those who want to lead us are asking, what would America think? The lowly workers at IADC are recognizing the contribution of Venezuela.
While all of this was continuing, so too was the construction on the site, in particular the spanning of the Yambo River. To get a better insight as to what the part of the construction entailed, I spoke with technical advisor to the IADC, Leonardo Perez, whose responsibilities included the supervision of the spanning of the Yambo River.
2 meses y medio comenzamos esta obra.
2.5 months ago we started working on this project. It's a large amount of excavation we have to do in this area, approximately 75,000 cubic meters. And as you can see from the video footage, a lot of the excavation works we have to do is stones, a lot of big stones. At present we are at 52% in the progress. Our aim is to complete the excavations in this area within the next month, because we now acquired an additional excavator to help us. We have been working very hard in this area, because where we are here now is where the runway will be crossing. And after that we have to do a lot of work, which is the installation of the armco, the structure, metallic armco structure. It's a big project. We have 5 rows of pipes, and each one is 305 meters long. But this has to be done, and once we complete this, then we proceed to doing, well, the other filling of the other areas, the green areas and the pavement works.
The International Airport Development Company, the IADC, took on as part of its mandate the role of educating the masses about the construction of the international airport seriously. That responsibility fell primarily to the communications unit, and at times assistance was sought from other departments within the company. One of those outreaches took us to the technical division of the St Vincent and the Grenadines Technical College. On this occasion, we heard first from architect Romel Oliver.
I am an architectural engineer at the IADC. I got my degree in architecture from the University of the Orient in Cuba, Santiago de Cuba. So I work along with the Cubans on the project, and I also work along with the chief project engineer, Mr. Jeffrey Cato. And my main responsibility has to do with the landside facilities, which is basically the buildings that are going up on site at the Argyle International Airport. These are the passenger terminal building, of course. You have your fire station, your aircraft rescue firefighting facility, the control tower, the electrical substation, and the cargo terminal. Where are we right now? Well, from the last report we had at the end of last month, the construction of the passenger terminal building and the substation is at about 72.5% completion. That's against a planned program at that same point. We were planning to be 63% completion. So we are about 9% ahead of schedule of the construction of the terminal building. The structure is already up completely. When was the last time any of you passed out there and had a look at the site? I think Miss Lewis brought a couple of you out there a couple months ago. I don't know if they are here. But right now, basically, the roof of the building, of the structure, is already on. The insulation, the roofing is on, and we are doing finishes within the building, tiling, and so forth. Also, right now we have just completed detailed designs of the fire station, and we have our quantity surveyors. They are doing some quantities. We're hoping and putting a tender document together. We hope to start construction soon.
Oliver was followed by head of the mechanical workshop, Stephen Seymour, who also brought with him a graduate of the technical college, who at that time was gainfully employed at the IADC's workshop. The highlight of this outreach was a presentation by electrical engineer Ms. Josette Graves, which evoked many questions from students and lecturers.
When I just started doing engineering and I would tell people, you know, I'm an electrical engineer, they would ask me, oh, so you install lights, you wire house and stuff like that. But what I would like you all to know that electrical engineering or being an electrical technician does not only deal with wiring houses and so forth. We have control systems that's very technical, very important, because these days everything is automated. So I know in your coursework you do electrical circuits. Where are the electrical people here? Okay. You do electrical circuits, you do electrical machines, you do some automation and control systems, and these are very important. Yeah, they're difficult too. So, but keep at it because it pays off. And looking at the trends throughout the world, engineers, engineering is one of the most highly demanded careers right now. So keep on track.
Meantime, back at the airport site, work continued to move apace with higher levels of concentration in the first and second kilometers of the site, in the areas of Fort Hill, just below Colonel Anderson Hill, and the eastern end in the vicinity of IADC's offices. In March 2013, the IADC's workshop was relocated from the area just below Colonel Anderson's Hill to allow the earthworks in that area to move ahead. Excavation, transportation, and compaction of soil were some of the main activities being undertaken. Compaction of soil on the eastern end was also ongoing in preparation for the construction of the aircraft rescue and firefighting station. Earthworks in the area earmarked for the terminal parking lot also began. The production of base material through the recently installed stone crushing plant was ongoing, with more than 40,000 cubic meters of material stockpiled in preparation for the laying of the base and pavement works. One of the bright spots in the construction of the Argyle International Airport was the construction of the passenger terminal building, which was moving rapidly and was on schedule to be completed by contract date of December 2013. By March 2013, over 76% of the work was completed. All internal and external wallings were completed, hence the entire structure for the terminal building was completed and the roof on the electrical substation was covered. In the area of airfield lighting, three shipments of supplies had arrived on site. For Vincentians everywhere, the realization of a long-held dream was just over a year away, and soon the horrors experienced at other regional airports will end and our people will travel with dignity and pride in being Vincentian. By May 2013, it was reported that the installation of conduits to bring cables across the runway in the area just below Johnson Hill had begun. Information was that this was the only point at which cables would cross the runway, and so these had to be installed before completion of the lane of the runway strip. Earthworks also continued in other areas of the site, with the aprons and taxiways shipping up nicely. The Argyle International Airport was expected to have three interconnecting aprons, a general aviation apron, cargo apron, and a commercial apron. Excavation work also continued on the hill which formerly housed the Argyle Roman Catholic Church. The box culverts in the second kilometer of the site were also nearing completion, and the process of filling in the spaces around the culverts had begun in some areas. These culverts were being put in place specifically to take runoff water from the pavement works down to the Argyle Sea. Meanwhile, the excitement continued to build around the passenger terminal building. Finishing touches on the roof continued in front of the building, and in the back, the roofing of the interconnecting walkway that links departure to arrival was all but complete. The priming of the outside back of the building was also moving with speed, as was the spray painting of the ceiling on the inside of the building. The glass wall on the airside or the front of the building was up, and on the ground floor, the stone walling of the block face of that floor continued. The roof of the electrical substation by this time was completely covered. Windows and doors had also been installed, and this building was almost complete. Undoubtedly, one of the biggest setbacks in the construction of the Argyle International Airport was the death on March 17, 2014 of the late Jeffrey Cato, the IADC's chief project engineer, and in many ways the main engine of the project, as so many things revolved around him. In commemoration of the life of the late chief project engineer Jeffrey Cato, the International Airport Development Company, the IADC, organized a memorial service inside the passenger terminal building at the check-in area. A very fitting venue, as the supervision of the construction of the passenger terminal building, including the formulation of contracts and the tendering process, were all part of his responsibilities. The memorial service paid homage to Jeffrey Cato and the work that he would have done on the Argyle International Airport project. It was a somber moment as staff at the IADC came out in their numbers to honor the life of Jeffrey Cato with their presence and to say thank you for services well rendered to the construction of the Argyle International Airport.
During these early years,
during those años,
Jeffrey assisted us in a myriad of ways.
Él nos ha ido en muchas maneras.
But his chief role was to help us determine whether we should build the airport at Kitchen or whether we should build it here at Argyle.
Pero su papel principal fue ayudarnos a decidir si construir el aeropuerto en otro lugar que se llama Kitchen o aquí en Argyle.
And based on the advice that he and other engineers in St. Vincent gave to the government,
y basado en los consejos que él junto con otros ingenieros de San Vicente que le dio al gobierno,
on August 8, 2005,
en el día 8 de agosto de 2005,
you would remember Honorable Prime Minister Ralph Gonsalves,
el primer ministro Gonsalves,
announced at the Methodist Church Hall,
anunció en el salón de la iglesia metodista,
that his government took the decision,
que su gobierno ha tomado la decisión,
to build an international airport at Argyle,
de construir un aeropuerto internacional aquí en Argyle.
So here we are.
Entonces aquí estamos.
And partly due to Jeffrey's advice and insights.
Y en parte debido al consejo de Cato.
The other role that Jeffrey played soon after the airport project was launched.
El otro papel que jugó Cato poco después de inició el proyecto del aeropuerto.
Was to advise us on the proposals made by the Cuban team of designers.
Fue aconsejarnos sobre las propuestas hechas por el grupo de proyectistas cubanas.
Sometime after July 2005,
un tiempo después de julio 2005,
we had a team of engineers from SECOA in Cuba.
Tuvimos un equipo de ingenieros de SECOA de Cuba.
Started working on the designs for the airfield.
Que habían empezado a hacer los proyectos para la pista.
And these engineers proposed three different alignments for the runway.
Y esos ingenieros hicieron tres propuestas, tres variantes para la pista.
And as part of Jeffrey's job as chief engineer at the Ministry of Works,
y una parte de su trabajo como jefe de los ingenieros en el Ministerio de Transporte,
his advice was important in determining which of the three alignments we selected.
Although the death of Chief Project Engineer Jeffrey Cato hit the project very hard, the pace of work on the construction of the Argyle International Airport was taken up several notches as the International Airport Development Company, the IADC, continued efforts to have construction work wrap up towards the end of 2014. The asphalt and concrete batching plants were assembled, tested and commissioned. The control tower and aircraft rescue and firefighting station, the ARFF, were under construction, with the ARFF scheduled to be completed by September 2014 and the control tower base by July 2014. The passenger terminal building was substantially completed and handed over by OECC, the contractors, to the IADC on November 30th, 2013. The outfitting of the building for operation was now ongoing, and most of the signs inside and on the building were installed, as were flight monitors and clocks. At the same time, preparation for the pavement of the commercial apron began, with the placement of aggregates on the surface. Meanwhile, a drain designed to take all runoff water from the terminal building was being constructed, and work on the runway continued, particularly in the third kilometer of the site. The Catholic Church halo was more than halfway down, and the runway was being extended in that area. Work on the removal of the petroglyphs hill continued, even as the IADC awaited the removal of the petroglyphs. Work on the city fences in the third kilometer of the site had started and was ongoing, with the reclamation of lands on the northeastern end of the runway. At the other extreme, on the southern end of the runway, the creation of an embankment, or what was called a backwater, at the foot of Stubbs Bay continued. This backwater was being built to facilitate the construction of the permanent access road to Waraku and Mount Pleasant, as well as other possible airport installations. As work on the project intensified, so too did work at the IADC's laboratory. Moving from the testing of soils and rocks, the work at the lab was expanded to include asphalt, concrete, and aggregate testing to meet the growing critical needs of the project. We spoke with personnel in the lab to find out more about their work and its significance. We began first with the concrete testing. Right now we are at the current facility that they have here at the lab at the Argyle International Airport, and as I mentioned before, this current facility is ready to help with the concrete testing. Now I'm seeing two different things in here. I'm seeing something that they tell me is a cylinder and also beams. I'm going to have Alejandro, who is the concrete specialist. He's a Cuban, of course, so he's going to be speaking Spanish. And we have Leon, who's going to do some interpretation for us. So we're going to ask Alejandro to explain exactly what the cylinders and the beams are used for, and just explain generally the whole testing process here.
Well, first of all, he said that what we do here is that we control the quality of the concrete that we use in the works on site at the airport.
Como del hormigón que se recibe de otras plantas para colocar en la obra.
And concrete that we receive from other concrete plants that are poured here on site. And he said that we've also done some concrete mix design using materials prepared here on site at the crusher plant to, in order to design a concrete mix. The basic criteria that we use to design the concrete is the flexural and compressive strength of the concrete. Right, so here in the curing tank, we have cylindrical specimens and we have beam specimens.
Resistencia a la compresión del hormigón.
The cylindrical specimen is used to measure the compressive strength test of the concrete.
Y las vigas se utilizan para medir la resistencia a la flexión del hormigón.
And the beams are used to measure the flexural strength of the concrete.
Following that, we turned our attention to soil, aggregate, and asphalt testing. Okay, we are inside the lab here at the Argyle International Airport project site, and with me I have Raimundo Perez. He is the soil testing specialist, and I believe they will have a more technical term for that, name, and you will tell me in a minute. So this is Raimundo, and we have the translator for today, Natoya, who has been assigned to the lab to help with the translations here. Raimundo, could he just give us the proper name for his position, please?
He's a lab and field specialist.
Okay. Now you are charged, you are the soil expert here, and you are charged with ensuring that whatever soil is being used here at Argyle is tested first. That's correct?
He says that, yes, he's in charge of the all the soil that are used here in the construction. He's in charge of classifying the soils and determining the use according to the function that they would be playing here in the construction.
Okay. Why is there a need for testing the soil?
Porque se hace ensayos de suelo.
Es necesario conocerlo en laboratorio para chequear en obra.
He says that it's necessary to know the behavior of the soils in the lab and also on site, on the field. You need to know the density, the humidity, and all of the other characteristics or properties that this soil have, so you can better know it and better make better use of it in the field.
We have been joined by Mercedes Rosell. She is an engineer and she's the chief technical person here at the lab. She's in charge of basically everything, even though we have experts, but she has to ensure that everything is done according to the standards that they have set for themselves here at the lab. Where we're standing here is where they actually do the aggregate testing, and she's also able to help us to walk us through what they do for the asphalt testing. We are going to start with the aggregate because we have some samples here. I don't believe we have any asphalt samples, but she will still talk to us about it. Previous to the arrival of the stone crusher, what we basically did was soil testing in the small lab over there. Now that we have gotten to this stage of the project, we have had to expand the lab to include asphalt, aggregate, concrete testing, in addition to the soil testing. So this is kind of new to us, the aggregate testing. For those of you who are watching the program and you're wondering what aggregate is, you know, the non-technical mind like me, we don't use those terms regularly. The aggregate, I would call them, you know, the small stones that they crush from the crusher. and they have different sizes, and they refer to them as different grades. This is what they test to ensure that this material, when it is placed on the runway or it is used in the asphalt, is really the best material to be used. Okay, so Mercedes is in charge of that. Exactly what is involved in aggregate testing?
Por medio del ensayo de abrasión Los Ángeles. Yeah.
She says that the aggregate tests include checking the aggregates for contaminants. We also do the abrasion test. We also do the granulometric test to know the decomposition, the different sizes that it has. We also do the elongated and rounded aggregate test as well.
If you can just give us quickly a rundown as to the test that you do for the asphalt.
The most important test that we do here is the first thing we have to verify the asphalt itself that the company buys to actually make the asphalt mix. Then the next thing we do is that we do the mixing of the asphalt and we verify its stability and its deformity and all of that. Then the next step is to test the asphalt that is actually being prepared in the plant for these same properties, for deformation and for stability.
After more than 5 years of trying to safely remove and relocate the Yanbu petroglyphs, the IADC was seeing the light at the end of the tunnel, with word in June 2014 that help was on the way to assist with the removal and relocation of the petroglyphs. When the Argyle International Airport began construction, the International Airport Development Company, the IADC, in collaboration with the St Vincent and the Grenadines National Trust, promised Vincentians that it will do all within its power to save the nation's treasures, the petroglyphs at Argyle, and it stuck to that promise. Over the years, the National Trust sought expertise around the world to have these petroglyphs safely removed and relocated. These range from the Egyptians to the Australians and finally the Argentinians, who spearheaded the actual move and relocation. The four-member team from Argentina was headed by archaeologist Dr. Monica Biron and included Horacio Villalba, Dario Guayanes, and Juan Pablo Villalba. We spoke to Dr. Biron about their work here and her expectation for the successful removal of the petroglyphs.
Well, thank you very much. I'm very glad to stay here for the second time.
Okay, now you are here, I mentioned, to assist us with the removal of the petroglyphs. You came before, you saw, and you are back, which means that you are convinced that you can have this work done. Tell us about that and how you're going to go about it.
Well, for the first time when I saw this, I thought it was impossible. But when I calmed, when I thought about it, I thought maybe I know people who can tell me if it is possible. So I communicated with the geologist I know. The one is there, he's there, Horacio Villalba. And I showed him the photographs. When I was staying here, I sent him the photographs. I tell, we must save these engravings, because they are important for people of St Vincent and the Grenadines. And these are important for me too, because they are the heritage of humanity. And well, we were working during a month and a half about, trying to get all the necessary stuff, tools, to get the documentation necessary to achieve the rescue.
Would you have done similar work like this in other countries, or maybe in Argentina? So this is the first experience for you?
Yes, this is the first experience for me, and this is, I think this is one of the only opportunities I've seen to save petroglyphs in this way. Because generally we rescue the images, we copy them, we reproduce them, but to save the complete block of petroglyph, the true block, I don't think there are many cases in the world.
Before leaving St. Vincent and the Grenadines on June 17, 2014, the team, assisted by IADC's Environment and Planning Officer, Kamitha John, manager of the SVG National Trust Lavon Bentick Phillips, Larson Bonnady of Samuel Tools and Rentals, and historian Morrison Basden, successfully extracted 8 large rocks bearing a total of 11 petroglyphs. The last remaining rock bearing 2 petroglyphs was successfully removed by IADC's Châteauyer-Che contingent. With me, I have the chairman of the St. Vincent and the Grenadines National Trust, Mrs. Louise Mitchell-Joseph. And I know for you, Louise, that this has been a long and arduous task, and I know that you're happy that you're at this stage. Now, I know that, but let the people hear from you exactly how you're feeling at this point where you are in this project.
Jennifer, I feel so proud and so happy. There were so many times over the last 2 years where we felt like giving up. I mean, we found the experts to do this job from Egypt, and then Egypt descended into chaos with the Arab Spring, and then we were not able to have them return. And then we had another team from another country who offered to do it, who could have done it, but at the cost of $500,000, which we could not afford. So it was such a struggle, and it was so painful to think about the possibility that we would have lost this piece of our heritage. Because for me, this is where our Vincentian identity is supposed to start. It's supposed to start with our ancestors who came here in the dugout canoes, and when they were here, they left tracings of their history with these petroglyphs. So for me to have lost this would have been an absolute tragedy. So when the Argentinians came to our rescue, it was just the most amazing thing to happen. So I definitely want to thank Minister Camilo Gonsalves, because it's the work in his Ministry of Foreign Affairs why we're able to have this team from Argentina coming and doing this for us for free. So, I mean, I'm absolutely thrilled. And also, I must mention that so far it's been a successful exercise. Many experts told us that these rocks would actually fall apart when you tried to move them. And so I believed that most likely that was true. And the question was, how many cracks would there have been, and how would we have put it back together? But the Argentinians, with their expertise, they've been able to remove so far 4 of the most important images completely intact. I mean, it is just like a blessing.
It was now August 13th, 2014, 6 years into the construction of the Argyle International Airport, and we continued to receive many questions regarding the project. One of the areas of concern, and for which there were numerous questions, was the wind studies. IADC had been collecting wind data from March 2006. Wind data was collected and analyzed by meteorologists from Venezuela, E.T. Joshua Airport, Cuba, and the Caribbean Meteorological Organization, the CMO, all of whom had submitted reports of their analysis. In the most recent reports, the CMO analyzed data for a 45-month period ending December 2012 from the 3 weather stations at Argyle. The results of their analysis showed that the wind blows predominantly from the east-northeast to east-southeast, hence crosswinds would always be present at the airport. However, the data also showed that the mean monthly crosswind component was relatively low and, on average, less than 10 knots based on the International Civil Aviation Organization's ICAO recommendations. This crosswind component should not affect the safe operation of the Argyle Airport for the smallest aeroplanes, and it is those whose reference field is less than 1,200 meters. After 6 years of construction, the IADC had also commenced the process of inviting firms to submit proposals for the financing, construction and operation of a fixed base operation and several aircraft hangars. It was expected that these facilities would be designed, constructed and made ready for airport operations in 2015. Design works for the access and circulation roads were also completed to facilitate the construction of the access roads to the passenger and cargo terminal buildings, public and commercial parking areas in front of the passenger terminal and the circulation roads. Up to August 13, 2014, the cargo terminal access road had been partially constructed to facilitate transit for the delivery of construction material to the passenger terminal building construction site, and to provide a temporary access to Argyle and Waraku. Construction of the access road to the passenger terminal building and the construction of the parking lot were both at advanced stages. As it relates to the Argyle Gardens Access Road, lands for the construction of this road were surveyed and acquired in 2012. Designs to facilitate earthworks were also completed. In 2014, the Prime Minister, Dr. Rav Gonsalves, made another visit to the facility, bringing with him this time his cabinet colleagues.
Sometime last year, we would have got involved in a tendering process, invited to be tender, but to tender on this project by IADC. And somewhere around January, my memory is that there were four or five regional, and OECC was involved in the bidding process as well. So there were four or five tenderers, and we were the successful tenderer. And we were awarded the contract and started to work in January. One of the conditions was for us to, there was some urgency in getting the tower base built, because there was a contract already formalized, I think, with Aeronav. So we had 6 months to get to this point.
My name is Richard Lubeck. I'm working for Aeronav out of Montreal, Quebec, Canada. I'm here to install the control tower. Right now we're in the progress of setting up our equipment and our material, and in the next week we'll be starting the installation of the control tower, which approximately will probably take a good 10-12 weeks until we get a completion of the building itself. Then afterwards we'll come in and do the electronics and whatnot to get this tower finished and up and running. So
meanwhile, excavation work continued on the area which was being excavated for the rerouting of a part of the Yambo River. For weeks in late 2014, heavy equipment operators worked steadily to remove most of the stones which they discovered in the area. Once the excavation work was completed in the area, the next step was to level this area, dig the foundation, and prepare the base for the installation of the culverts. Meanwhile, concrete work continued on the apron area as well as on the turning head at the northeastern end of the runway and on other areas around the site. The aircraft rescue and firefighting vehicles appear to have arrived early. However, as pointed out by CEO of the International Airport Development Company, Dr. Rudy Matthias, the trucks were ordered to arrive on time for an anticipated end of 2014 opening of the airport. However, that was not to be, as several factors, including the weather and insufficient equipment, caused significant delays to the project. Speaking at a reception ceremony at the Camden Park Container Port, Dr. Matthias pointed out that the purchase of the aircraft rescue and firefighting vehicles was only one of several major things that will be bought.
And in the coming months, we will be buying another set of equipment for the terminal building. And we are talking here, perhaps the biggest of these will be two jet bridges that we are buying to install on the terminal building, to facilitate the efficient emplaning and deplaning of passengers that arrive on the larger jets. We will of course be buying things like conveyor belts, counters, scanners, and things of that sort that you would normally expect to find in a terminal building. So that work is ongoing right now. And I am sure you will be back here again sometime in the near future to witness the official handing over of some of the large piece of equipment for the Argyle International Airport.
Also addressing the reception ceremony was Prime Minister Dr. Rav Gonsalves. Speaking at the ceremony, Dr. Gonsalves noted how pleased he was that the trucks had arrived.
These three firefighting vehicles, an aircraft rescue, they had to be ordered to specifications. And the specifications were not set by Dr. Matthias, but by technical people who are aware of firefighting vehicles, aircraft rescue. And they had to be built to the specifications. In addition to these three vehicles, these firefighting vehicles, there's a container load of spare parts, I think for a year. There's a container load with them. And equipment, supplementary equipment and the like. These three aircraft and firefighting vehicles and what we have in the containers, ancillary equipment and spare parts, cost $2.7 million. I just want you, for rough, if you want to do it roughly, $3 million US is just over $8 million EC. So you're talking about a number knocking its head to $8 million EC.
He also spoke about the financing of the trucks and other equipment for the project.
In the year 2012, wasn't it 2012, Rudy? I went to Parliament in May of that year with a supplementary set of estimates and a supplementary appropriation bill amounting to $80 million US approximately, just over $200 million Eastern Caribbean. And I pointed out that this was the financing which the IADC had advised me in the year 2012 that we required to complete the airport and have it ready for operation, barring some equipment. But among the items listed was just over $10 million US, which I specified to be borrowed from the Bank of Nova Scotia. And I outlined that we had already signed all the loan agreements. And I myself had put my signature as the Minister of Finance on those agreements for the first $5 million approximately. And that $5 million approximately was to be used largely to purchase goods and services out of Canada. And a major item there was the control tower. And as you know, a Canadian firm has come down to build the control tower. The equipment, the pieces for the control tower and the base came in from Canada. And that because we were buying substantially Canadian goods and services for that $5 million, that we were getting a very special rate of interest on account of the fact because it's Canadian goods and services. For that part of the operation, we were getting a number under 4%. Now, if we had to borrow it ourselves without the guarantee by the Export Credit Corporation of Canada, we will pay 8%, 8.5%. But because this export agency from Canada, state agency, guaranteed the payment, that if we don't pay, they will pay, and then the export agency will come for us for the payment, we get the money cheaper.
In spite the plans and the Herculean efforts to have the Argyle International Airport in operation by the end of 2014, that was not to be, as several variables combined to frustrate the realization of that goal. However, with the project far advanced, but yet quite a bit of work remaining to be done, the schedule was rearranged and all eyes were now set on operations by mid 2015. In part 5 of the IADC's documentary, we hope to bring you the final stages of construction leading up to the operation of the Argyle International Airport, and if possible, the first day of operations at the airport.